Glad you're with us this morning. We are very blessed and honored today to have the Bush family with us, Pat and his wife Dina and their son Kevin. They're traveling to Cambodia coming up in July, and Pat and Dina and Kevin are going to be coming and sharing with us this morning, and then we're going to be taking a special love offering for their ministry. And so we're looking forward to just a great morning today as we worship the Lord. There's a lot going on, so we want to make you aware of that. This Saturday, Women's Ministry will be meeting at the Sisters Tea House and Mentor at 9 a.m. You can see my wife for that. She has a sign-up sheet to pass out to you. And then also, we want to make you aware that on March 18th. March 18th. March 18th, we have our men's breakfast that will be taking place here at Victory Lane. We have a guest speaker that will be with us that morning, so we trust that you'll be with us. And then also, we want to make you aware tonight of the worship and prayer night tonight that is taking place at Kirtland Christian Fellowship. You should have a handout in your bulletin. This is going to be a night where we have 12 churches combined that are coming together. It's a prayer night called Seeking God, Valuing Life. It's spirit-led, spirit-driven worship and prayer. You don't want to miss the opportunity. It's going to be from 6 to 7:30. We're anticipating, if you were part of the one that we did at Menor Civic Center a few years ago, we had about 600 people at that event. We're anticipating a few hundred people tonight for this time, so you may want to get there about 5:30-ish or so. Make sure you get you a seat. Starts at 6 p.m. It's going to be a night, just a great night. Hannah's home will be with us. They'll be sharing Right to Life. We'll be there as well. And then there'll be a time of light refreshments afterwards. So that begins at 6 p.m. Kirtland Christian Fellowship on Route 306. It's a church that sits way in the back and is next door to a bar with a volleyball court. So trust that you'll be part of that evening. Would you go ahead and stand with us today? And let's invite the presence of the Holy Spirit into our morning worship service. Amen. Father, today we honor you and give you glory and praise for this day. This is a day that you have made that we will rejoice and be glad in it. So today, Father, we come and we want to lift up the name of Jesus. We give you thanks and glory for this day. And Lord, everything, God, that we say, everything we do today, it's all about you this morning. And so, Father, we honor you, give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Amen.
suffered as if he did.
Forever, awesome and great is your name. You are the
song. Heaven's mercy sing. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. And I will. I want to see your Yeah.
morning, we thank you today because let our hearts hunger for more of you, Lord. We desire, God, to have that fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit in our lives. And we thank you this morning because of your great, great, amazing grace that you have for your children, Lord. And we thank you this morning, God, as we worship you, Lord. We continue, Lord, to just be sensitive to the things that the Holy Spirit is leading us to do. And Lord, we want to give you thanks and honor for this day, God, because of the privilege we have to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Yes. And Father, we honor you for that. And we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated this morning. Praise the Lord. We're glad you're with us today. And we have a very full day today as we are going to have, in just a moment, our ushers are coming right now. We're going to take up our morning tithes and offerings. And I'm going to ask Dave Sturgill, if Dave, you'll come and you have, you're going to share, I think, about that one gentleman. Going to share about that gentleman this morning. Amen.
A couple weeks ago, I was presented with my credentials, and it wasn't long after that I had the opportunity to put them to use. My old youth group leader called me and said she knew a 62-year-old gentleman that was in jail. The nice thing about these credentials is they will get you in jail any day, any time, and they got to let you in to see him. So this guy didn't know me, but she said she was going to send me. So I went there to see him. His name is Ken. And the reason why I'm telling you about this is I'd like you to join with me in intercessory prayer for Ken, because he's out on bond right now. He's going to have to do time for his drug abuse offenses. But he wanted to contact me, so I called him last night to see what he wanted. And he just wanted to talk. He didn't ask, no request or anything of me. But I found this interesting that when he was 17, he asked Jesus to be his Savior at the Chardon Assembly of God. Is any lights going on? Okay. And he told me when I went to visit him that he has prayed before and that he has been doing a lot more praying because he knows he's in hot water. He's not trying to get out of it, but he's asking for leniency and mercy because of his extenuating circumstances. But the fact of it is, his heart is open to the Lord. He's definitely wanting the Lord to come to his aid. He has some physical problems, some medical problems that he would like the Lord to touch him with and to help. And this morning, he was supposed to be picked up by my friend and her husband and taken to their church. So and he asked me about my church. I says, well, as a matter of fact, I go to Assembly of God. He goes, oh, really? So we shared a little bit. And he's not refusing to be picked up and come to church. So, I mean, how many times is it that that's the big challenge for us, getting somebody that we've invited to actually attend church?
Yeah.
And he's already there.
Yep.
So I felt if we could just say a prayer for him, that the Holy Spirit would continue to deal with his heart, that the Lord would show him the path that the Lord has for Ken. So that's simply why I'm here, and that's my request. Thank you.
Amen. Let's go ahead and do that right now. And Dave, if you'll stay right up here. And let's pray for him. His name is Ken. And let's just believe that God will continue to get a hold of his heart. Amen. Father, today as we stand in agreement with our brother, we thank you, God, that you've given Dave a vision, Lord, to minister inside the jails and the hospitals. And Father, with those who come in contact with, Lord, right now we specifically lift up Ken to you. And we pray, God, that you would do a work in his heart and his life. Right now, I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that he would show true, genuine repentance, that he has a desire to surrender completely and totally to you. I pray that you continue to use our brother as a vehicle, God, to touch his heart with the gospel and the love of Jesus Christ. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Amen. That's right. Amen. That's very true. Praise God. Amen. Let's pray for our morning tithes and offerings. And again, this is separate. We'll be taking a special love offering at the end of the service for Pat and his family. Amen. Thank you, Lord, today for the opportunity to continue to worship with our tithes and offerings. We ask, God, you would continue to bless and do a great work, God, that you continue to do. Bless the gift and the giver, those that can't, God, that we would honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, it's my privilege today to introduce. I had the opportunity to get to know Pat Bush a couple of years ago. And occasionally we even run into each other at Walmart. And when we run into each other at Walmart, you know, when you get talking about the Lord, it's a good thing. Amen. And I think the last time we talked, we were there for about a good 30 minutes and didn't accomplish any shopping at all. And but it's been a true joy to help you identify a little bit more with Pat and Dina and their son, Kevin. Many of you know Jared Bush. Jared was very instrumental in helping Billy get our website going here. And Billy dates Mike and Melissa's daughter, Allie. And so we're honored this morning. Oh, I'm sorry, Jared. Hey, we're going to rewind that tape. Rewind that tape. Jared dates Mike and Melissa's daughter, Allison. Okay, praise the Lord. Oh, man, it gets better, trust me. But it's my honor to introduce to you today, Pat, would you come? And let's give a nice hand clap of appreciation to our brother as he comes this morning.
Thank you. Can you all hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not used to this kind of a mic. First, I just want to thank you all for having us. I want to say a special thanks to Mike for, you know, just thinking of us. It was such an honor when we heard that he had asked if we could come and share. And thank you so much, Pastor Bill, for having us here. You know, I was thinking as we were coming here, we had a chance to share at our church, and that's our home family. But by it being able to come here, to me, well, first of all, it's a stretch. This isn't my comfort zone. But I was thinking about how, you know, we're reaching even farther. The tent pegs are stretching out. And this is just a beginning of our stretching out of our comfort zone. So what I'm hoping is maybe some of the things that we're going to share as we talk about our road to get to Cambodia. Maybe it'll touch one of you guys. Maybe it'll, you know, just let you know that God just uses truly the ordinary people. And I know we've all heard it before, but I hope you see we're just ordinary people, and he can use us and he can use you. I was wondering if you would all just raise your hand if you've never been on a missions trip before. Okay. Out of the people who haven't, I'm wondering, have you ever imagined yourself being on a missions trip? Amen. Amen. So, you know, that's the beginning, and I've never been on a missions trip before, and I'm almost 50. Don't tell anybody. But, you know, when someone would share, you know, most of the time when I would see other people sharing about missions trip, they just seemed to all have it all together. They were missionaries, maybe, and they already have been doing it for a while. And I would just see this vision of me doing it someday. But as soon as that happened, I would have all these fears start to come up. And then from there, well, I had lots of reasons why it wasn't time for me to go. I'm never, you know, I'm not going to do that, at least not now. So how did God get someone like me, some like Kevin Pat to say yes. Well, Pat's been on a missions trip before with Jared. They went to the Dominican. This is a first for me and Kevin. About the way I travel back in time about this is about 7 years ago, Pat and I took a youth group that actually Jared and Allie were in at the time, from Here's Hope to a church, and there was an event there where a spokesman for Compassion International was there. And from that and hearing the needs of the children, we decided to support a girl named Esther. Do you have Esther there, Mike?
That's right.
Okay. Yeah. So we supported her for about 5 years. She's from Tanzania. But, you know, as awesome as that was, when you're writing letters back and forth, they only write a little something. It's all very vague. You don't really get to know them. And my heart would always ache to want to be able to go to her, to hug her, you know, and just talk to her face to face. The only time I can say that I just really felt close to her was when I would pray for her. You know, that's when we're connected in the spirit. That's when we're close. But I always wondered, would I ever see her one day? So then after that, about 3 years ago, we have friends named Matt and Bridget Lynch, and their family moved to Hungary. And we were good friends with them at the time already, and we were just so impressed to hear that they would take their young children and leave everything out of their comfort zone, their business, everything, and move to Hungary to do missions. When you hear other people speak, if you don't know them closely, it's like, oh, that sounds really great. But when you're closer to it, then you're thinking, oh, my gosh, my friends are going to move, and they're going to leave everything. And they're just wonderful people. They just really have encouraged us. So we began to support them, and we've been supporting them ever since. They're still there. About 2 years ago, one of my friends, his name's John, and John Boyer, he had gone on the same mission trip that we're going to go on. And that's through Gateway. And I probably should have started out with that, but Gateway Church is in Ashtabula. And they have a worship team called, they call it The Wave. They have worship nights once a month, The Wave. And I had been going there for many years, most Friday nights that they would have that. But their team has gone four times. This will be their fourth time going to Cambodia. So John went on the third time. He went the last time. When he came back, he just knew God was calling him to Cambodia. And he, again, here's a dear friend of ours. He left everything. He sold everything. And all by himself moves all the way to Cambodia, where he didn't know anybody. Just the way that God gets a hold of your heart in some people's lives, it just blows me away. So we continue to support him. And he, can you bring up a couple more pictures here, John? I just want to see, these are some of the children that John's been ministering to. He started what's called a house of prayer, and he is working with XP Ministries, which is what we'll be doing too. So they're hands and feet right there, in Cambodia, and it's really grown exponentially in just a year's time. These children come and they're hungry for God, and he has taught them how to hear God, how to pray for others, how to pray for their country, and they're ministering to their families, they're evangelizing, they're bringing friends to the Lord. So watching that progress is just amazing to me. He's constantly sending pictures out and videos that we get to follow. So lo and behold, with what I want to share is like the sowing that we did. We didn't even realize that years ago we just started sowing into something that God was going to do in our lives. But this ministry, with the children, again, seeing those pictures and seeing those videos, I just wondered, what would it be like? Again, these children are beautiful, and what would it be like to be able to hold them? What would it be like to just tell them that, you know, Jesus loves them, that I love them? You know, when you start to think about it, you start to share about it, your heart starts to warm up to it. But I will tell you, I know for a fact that it won't be until we're face-to-face with these children that our hearts will really, really break. I have friends, some of the people that have gone are friends with me that have shared what was it like their first time. And one of the ladies said that when she got on the was on the bus to get to Phnom Penh, which is the capital of Cambodia, where we'll be staying, she said instantly you saw poverty. And it just kept going and kept going and kept going. Poverty. Just. And she just said, Lord, why? Why am I here? Who am I? And he said, you are light in a dark place. And we don't realize. I know many of you have probably already heard this. Pastor Bill probably shares all the time. You don't realize what light you are when you're in a dark place. So we don't expect to transform Cambodia because we're going to go on this missions trip, but we do expect to shine the light of Jesus into these lives and also to encourage the missionaries who are there now. We look forward to seeing our friend John and knowing that they're going to continue on the work. So who knows what will happen after that, but I just want you to know sometimes, you know, those pictures that you have when someone's sharing, don't be afraid. Be courageous and actually pray about it, because that's what happened. I asked John about 6 months ago to pray that our family would go to Cambodia, and that was a courageous prayer, because I know that God can answer those kinds of prayers. So about only a month later, there was an announcement from Gateway that they were going to take another team again. It's been a couple years since they gone, and that was awful close to when I asked for prayer. So I thought, well, gee, maybe this is the Lord. Maybe he actually wants us to go. That scared me. So part of me wanted to go, and part of me wanted to stay here in our comfortable United States of America, right? But I dared to pray, and after that, Gateway was having a conference that I went to. Almost didn't go, but when I found out some more details about it from a friend, I wasn't even going to share this, but I just want to tell you it's these little things, that just these pieces of the puzzle that are just amazing that God puts in place for you. But I've been to a lot of conferences about healing, and I thought that's all this is about. Wonderful, but life is busy and you just don't go to everything. Well, a friend of mine talked more to me about it. She's like, well, it's on healing and worship. And I've recently become a worship leader. So it was like, okay, well, I guess I should go. I mean, I'm not even putting pieces of the puzzle together myself yet. So I go there with the thoughts about this missions trip. My first fear was, and I don't know, maybe women can connect with this better, but what if I go with this team who, hey, they've gone 3 times together, they go to the same church together, who am I? I'm going to be this person on the outside. That was a big fear for me. Well, when I was at the conference, I started to share with a couple of the leaders that'll be going that I was interested in going. By the time I was done sharing my thoughts, I was in tears and so were they. And God just connected our hearts and made me feel like, okay, that's taken care of. You know, you're connected. It doesn't matter that you go to a different church or whatever. So he started to take care of some other fears. The next thing was, well should I, if I just go by myself and the family doesn't go, you know, what do I do? And I thought, well, it's now settled in my head. God somehow settled it in my head. I'm supposed to go no matter what. So I just kept praying for Pat and Kevin and Jared. And Jared's been on many missions trip, and I kind of had a feeling he probably wouldn't make it to this one as busy as he is with Altered. But Pat, do you want to share for yourself how that worked with you? Pat would come to me, and he'd be like, oh, I really don't. I'm not feeling like I'm supposed to go. And I was like, really? Oh my gosh. Okay. So I was getting pretty convinced the couple times that he kept saying, he's not going to go. So I just kept praying, God, you know, if he's supposed to, you know, you'll make it happen. Well, one night he just was up all night. And so he came to me that morning after the, see, now you should share. Go ahead.
All right. All right. Thanks for your grace on this. Well, Dina was supposed to go to a meeting. It was a Are You Locked In meeting, basically just trying to get a consensus of who's going so everyone can meet each other. And so she asked me, please, could you just stand in for me? Because if there's any information on the trip that I need, you need to take notes. So I said, all right. So I asked Kevin if he wanted to go with me, just to go with me, you know. So he said, sure, I'll go. So we went there, and they were talking about the trip and their experiences from the previous trips. And I'm just sitting there being quiet, just listening. And Brian Wright, the leader that's going, he looked at me, he's square in the eye, and he goes, you're here for a reason. I said, well, I kind of know what the reason is. I'm here to take notes. You know, my wife told me she can't be here. She has to be at a worship practice, and I have to be here to take notes. So I understand that. I said, but I'm not committed. I'm just here to take notes. So he goes, yeah, but I just have a feeling you're here for another reason. I'm like, no, I'm just listening like that, you know. So we just listened in and got to hear some testimonies and the plan and just a rough plan and the expenses and all that. And so I went home and I basically just said, you know, I don't know if I'm led to do this. I mean, what he saw in me over me or whatever, I don't know what it is, but I just don't feel convinced. So it was probably two or three nights. I couldn't sleep at all. I mean, God was waking me up. I kept visioning myself going. I kept wrestling with it. I mean, wrestling with God, you know. And finally, I think it was like the Jacob wrestling with God, you know. He's wrestling and breaking my ribs and kicking me around. And finally, Adina was making dinner one day, and I was sitting in the chair, and I was like, oh, I'm not going to be at peace until I tell her I can go. So I said, hey, could you come here a minute? And she goes, sure. And I go, I'm pretty convinced I'm supposed to go too. And I said, I have not gotten sleep. I think I can finally get some sleep now. So, well, then Kevin, I'm not sure how Kevin heard, but he came downstairs, and oh, that's right, Kevin came downstairs, and we said, well, Kevin, myself and your mom are going to be going. And he said something where he was studying math, because we homeschool Kevin, and he was studying math, and a question was asked about, it brought up like Cambodia in his math or something like that. And I may be getting the story a little bit off, but he said, what is the odds of getting Cambodia in your math? So he goes, maybe that's a sign too. So we were talking, and now we're all going. So, and then believe it or not, that night I slept like a baby. The wrestling match was gone. So here we are. I believe that we were all three called to go, and we're all at peace with it. So with that, I'll
see, you do a much better job. But yeah, Kevin, actually, I think he wanted to share. He had already said yes to the Lord. I guess I just think you're kind of young and you're ready for an adventure, right?
Just here's the thing. Basically, your mind tells you a lot of things and you have to just ignore it. That's basically it. Just say, I'm not going to listen to the mind. Just go with whatever your heart says, pretty much. So.
Yeah, that's what it's all about. You know, I used to think, oh, you have to feel like this. You have to feel like you want this or whatever. Your feelings will lie to you, too. But they just start to catch up is all that happens. And that's what happens. You know, he said yes, and then it was after that that he got that question. That's all Kevin needed, you know. He probably didn't even need that little bit of confirmation, but God's so good. He gives us more than what we need. He just put that little confirmation in there for Kevin. As you can see, I needed a lot more than that to get me to go. So God was good. I do want to share that we are addressing the human trafficking that's going on in Cambodia. And obviously, y'all probably know it's bad in the United States now, too. But Cambodia is a very poor country, and Kevin's going to share a little bit about the history and what happened. Why is it such a poor country? It's starting to come back a bit, but it's set a bad precedence for the children there. So with our friend John being there, I asked him, what's it like? What are you seeing there? And I just want to read what he wrote back. He says, the people I have met here that are being trafficked on have been trafficked and moved around a lot. They're giving a quota. These children are given a quota to meet every day of money to make or men to pleasure. And if they don't, they are beaten and starved. Many get sold into slavery at age 11 or 12 to pay off their parents' debts. They belong to the restaurant or hotel until the debt is paid off. That's why this children's ministry is so extremely important, that these children have a safe place to go and cry out to God. And he hears them. He's hearing their prayers, and he's making a change there. But the children are vulnerable. The women are vulnerable. Sometimes there's I saw a story of a boy whose father was killed in the war, and the mother said to him, you know, you need to go into the city because I can't feed you. Maybe you can make some money there. And there's still just these lies out there from the people who abuse these children that's what, you know, we're going to take care of you. You'll make some money, and this is how you're going to survive. And then they end up becoming slaves. So I'm going to let Kevin share a little bit about the history of Cambodia.
So, as you already know, Phnom Penh is where we will be staying in Cambodia. We'll be arriving there and pretty much staying again. It is the capital and largest city in Cambodia, and it was once known as the Pearl of Asia. And the city's shine was tarnished by war and the effects by revolution. In 1968, the Khmer Rouge was formed. Their leader was a man named Pol Pot, and he led the Khmer Rouge for 34 years. His party indoctrinated Marxist ideology and declared that the rural peasant farmers were the true working class force of the revolution. The Khmer Rouge government arrested, tortured, and eventually executed anyone suspected of belonging to several categories of supposed enemies, including anyone with connections to the former Cambodian government or with foreign governments, professionals and intellectuals. In practice, this included anyone who had educations, people who understood foreign language, and even people who required glasses, which, according to the regime, meant that they spent too much time reading books instead of working, which, ironically, Pol Pot himself was a well-educated man who had a taste for French literature and spoke fluent French. Ethnic Vietnamese, ethnic Chinese, ethnic and other minorities in Eastern Highlands, Cambodian Christians, Muslims, and the Buddhist monks, economic saboteurs, many former urban dwellers were deemed guilty of sabotage due to their lack of architectural ability. Modern research has located 20,000 mass graves from the Khmer Rouge era all over Cambodia. On the screen, you will see a picture of the killing fields. Various studies have estimated the toll of between 1.4 million and 2.2 million. An additional 300,000 Cambodians starved to death between 1979 and 1980, largely as a result of the aftereffects of the Khmer Rouge policy. Cambodia is gradually recovering. The majority of its population is too young to remember the Khmer Rouge era, and their generation is still affected by the traumas of that past.
Okay, so we have the what led us to this point, and the things we're going to be doing, the various ministries while on the trip, include praying for the youth. Those youth over there need prayer, and we encourage you, please pray for us and them as we're over there. We're going to be praying for various things. Only God knows right now what's, I mean, we have no idea, really. We're going to have wave worship nights. I don't know if Dina mentioned the wave worship they have. Has anybody been to a wave worship out in Austinburg? So some people are familiar with that. It's mostly to help us at the end, because we're going to see a lot of things. And some of it's going to be just very burdensome. And we all know that even Jesus, when he would go out amongst the people, he took time to be by himself and to be with the Father and to worship. It's very important that for our spiritual health we go through some of these things too. Giving gifts to the children. We're going to be bringing suitcases, extra suitcases, aside from our own, with gifts, including hygiene products and shoes. I was telling Pastor Bill this morning, when I was just kind of writing some specifics down under gifts to the children, I was like struggling with this, because I'm thinking, well, what kind of things can I share with you guys? So Dina's like, hey, you know, tapping on her, hey, we got to get going, you know, we got to get there a little early. So I'm motivating, I'm getting things done, and I'm getting ready, and I have my phone sitting on the bathroom vanity, and I hear the humming. So I look at it, and sure enough, it's an instant message from Andrea Asen, who is in Cambodia now. She's like part of the field group that we're going to be hooking up with. She writes, we are going to need Bibles, shoes, oral hygiene, these kind of things, etc. So I'm like, oh my gosh. Thank you, Lord. I mean, he heard it. He knew what I needed at the time to write down here. So he's like, from Cambodia, 12 hours away. You know, I mean, 12 hours our time away, you know, halfway around the world. And then I'm getting this thing at the moment I need it. So anyway, we're going to be doing evangelism activities, counseling the women in the sex trade. I doubt if the guys will be doing that. Probably the women will be doing that. Praying for areas of oppression, urban slums and garbage dump communities. Praying for the sick. There's plenty of people there with lots of different things we've probably never seen. We're going to be praying for them. Handing out Bibles. Service projects, helping them build and, you know, recover, and partnering activities with other local ministries. XP Missions is the one that's over there we're kind of umbrellaing under. So we'll be partnering with them, and we're just going to be at their disposal. We learned a lot of things we won't know until we get there on what we're going to be doing. So this is just a list on some of the things. I'm probably missing some, but so that's pretty much what we're going to be doing while we're there. So I'll hand the mic over to Dean.
As far as the fundraising, they're estimating that we each need about 2,000, so say 6,000 altogether, and that should take care of our airfare and the lodging and food. Amen. And God's already just been so good. We've already been blessed. We have $3,500 towards our goal, and it's going to get taken care of. We're just fine. I just want you to know where we're at and how faithful God's already been for us. Our airfare is due 1st of May, so that's the biggest amount first, and after that we can continue to do fundraising or something. We're doing fundraising with Gateway. That fundraising, we've already done two different kinds and a few left to go. That goes in for the whole group. There's 20 of us going, and it's going to take a bit to get 20 people to travel around in the country. And we also, they've never been to Vietnam, but the plan is to go for at least one day to Vietnam. There's a special invitation that they received where there's a resort owner there, and he's Christian. He wants to bring in worship there. Our plan is to be out on the beach. Yay. Well, I don't know if I'll be happy then. It's supposed to be pretty hot, but we're going to be worshiping on the beach. That's the plan, and neat things for Vietnam too. We do have, we brought some papers with our contact information. Really, Facebook is something that we're using. So I have papers at one of your tables by the front door when you come in, if you're interested in, you know, seeing updates. Pastor Bill said he's going to ask us to come back maybe in September, and I'm super pumped about that because I can't wait to actually have the stories to share, and it'll be three of us with stories, so, and lots of pictures and videos, and we'll just have a great time. So I just thank you so much for having us today.
Folks, stay right up here with me. Yeah. Pat told me that he apologizes. He wanted to go 3 hours, but he wanted to be mindful of everybody, so he didn't take as much time as I gave him.
Next time, we'll have plenty more to
share. So, I'm going to ask Tony, if you'll have the ushers, will come at this point, at this time, and we're going to take up a special love offering. But let me, before you make out your check, if you're making out a check, make it out to the church. We're going to cut one check to them. I want to just take a moment, and I just want to lay out a challenge to this congregation. This church is a very giving church, and I'm very thankful for it. As many of you know, we shared a couple of weeks ago, we took our largest missionary offering for Pastor Jeremiah and Heather. Wouldn't that be a beautiful thing to see what this church can do? We can't put feet on the ground where Pat and Dina and Kevin are going, but we can sow our dollars into that field. Amen? And wouldn't it be a beautiful thing to know that we can go above and beyond maybe what the Lord's asking you to do? You might have in your mind, I'll just give $20, you know, hey, it's from the heart. It's not the dollar amount, it's the heart. But wouldn't it be a beautiful thing to be able to bless them with a great financial gift that would be able to help with those expenses? They're not, Pat and Dina and Kevin are not just like normal appointed missionaries that are going to be able to go into all the churches like a missionary could. It's by relationship is how they're building this. Now, I can tell you, it's great because after talking to Pat a little while, I know the King Zets and I know the Wrights. I've known them for over 20 years at Gateway Ashtabula Church. And I can tell you, Brian's father is a retired Assembly of God pastor enjoying life in Florida right now. And the King Zets, I used to work with Debbie King Zett at WCBJ Radio in Jefferson as a prayer line pastor. So I know these families very well. And Pat and Dina and Kevin are very locked in with a great group of people. But isn't it a beautiful thing that we get a chance to put feet to our faith and sow those seeds into that soil that we can be a blessing, just to be a part of in a tangible way to help them in a great way, amen? I'm going to ask if we could, before we take the offering, I'm going to invite the guys on the board, if they'll join me on the platform. And I want to ask the wives of the board members also to pray for Dina, lay hands upon Dina, and we're going to pray for her. And Dave Sturgill, if you'll join me up here as well, we want you to be able to be part of this as well. And so if you'll all join me up on this platform, and we're going to just believe for the Lord to speak to the hearts of our body, amen? And be able to just invest into this ministry in such a great and powerful way. Amen? Praise the Lord. Amen. Our gracious Heavenly Father, today as we stand in agreement for Pat and Dina and Kevin, we thank you for the heart, God, that you've given them feet to travel to Cambodia. Lord, this is a mission field that is very difficult in Asia. But God, you have given them a desire to minister in human trafficking, to minister to those that need the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray for this team. We pray, God, that your anointing, your blessing would be upon them. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that you would give them swift feet, Lord, to that hearts and lives would be changed through the blood and power of Jesus Christ. I pray today that you, by the presence and power of your Holy Spirit, would equip Pat and Dina and Kevin today. Anoint them, God, in the name of Jesus, to do your work. We ask that you would place a hedge of protection over them. God, watch over them as they travel with the rest of this team. And we honor you and thank you. And we pray, God, this offering that we take would be just a tangible way that we partner with them, that they know that they have a partner here in the United States that will be praying with them and that are going to go with them with the dollars that we sow into that soil. And we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Would you give this wonderful couple a nice hand clap of appreciation? Amen. Go ahead, gentlemen, if you'll take up the offering. And Billy, as soon as you get to the back, if you'll post that up there real quick. Amen. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Amen. Thanks, Kyle. I want to share before we close, I just want to take a moment for about the next 5-10 minutes, if you'll allow me. Something that I want to share that I think is of great importance to us as believers, as followers in Christ. This is going to lead into the message next week. But I want to share with you, this kind of is where we're going to be going next week. Still standing. The Bible teaches us in a very specific, very important way to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, all thy mind, and all thy strength. It also teaches us, love not the world, nor the things that are in the world. For any man that loveth the world, the love of the Father is not in him. What we need to be able to know, and next week I'll be talking to you about the importance of positioning ourselves, knowing that when the enemy comes at us like a flood, the enemy will come. He's out to steal, kill, and destroy. But God comes to give life, and he comes to give it more abundantly. Amen? And I want us to be able to know and understand that we're in a fight. And that as we're in that fight, we're going to be taking some shots that the enemy is going to try to get us with. But those shots will never compare the pain of staying the same of the pain that it takes to change. Because change really does hurt. But we still got to be able to stand when those shots are coming. And we got to know that we have a Savior, amen, who loves us unconditionally right where we're at, no matter how bad it is. And Paul tells us that whenever you face trials, it doesn't tell us that trials are optional in the life of a believer. But the question will be next week, are we still standing? How will we position ourselves knowing that the fight that we're in of what God wants to lead us to, what he wants to do in us and through us and for us? I believe that the ceiling can be raised, or so to speak, the bar, on the potential that God can give us as we fight the good fight of faith. I believe that the enemy comes in like a flood. I believe that there's things that are going to happen, spiritual warfare that takes place. We see it time and time again. But we know that the battle belongs to the Lord. The enemy's not going to leave you alone if you're doing something for the kingdom. If you're not doing anything at all, you're fine. You're fine. He's not going to mess with you. Where he's going to mess with us is when we're doing something for the kingdom. He's going to try to get us off course. But are we going to still stand? Are we still going to fight? And so next week, I'm going to talk to us about the three key factors of what it means to position ourselves for the fight. Amen? Father, we thank you today, Lord, that this is a day that you have made, that we will rejoice and be glad in it. And Lord, we thank you, God, for so many great things that have taken place this day. We pray, God, again, that as we go out through these doors, God, equip us to fight the good fight of faith. Lord, we thank you again for the opportunity to hear the heart of the Bush family. We pray, God, again, that as they go out, they put feet to their faith, Lord, that you would bless them. Whatever their hands finds to do to bring glory and honor to you, and that as they portray Christ with skin on, that lives will be changed in Cambodia for eternity. And Lord, we pray for their safety. We pray, God, that you will just continue to do great work through them with the team that is going. And Father, as we leave this place today, Lord, we want to continue to rejoice, give you honor, give you thanks, give you glory as we go out to serve you. And Lord, we look forward to the great things that are coming our way. And we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.